Brian Mullins the Fox Home Entertainment proudly presents The Roast Game, the entire timeline. Four must-see parts, including the following. All four seasons of The Roast Game Theory with Detective Brian Mullins the Fox. All rant/commentary videos on the topic of The Roast Game. All five dramas, including the three-in-one known as the Drama Triathlon. All four Roast Game documentaries. All three research videos spanning from early 2020 to 2021. The Canadian Roast Game Theory, the three-part series, and all the other videos that technically prove The Roast Game in both America and Canada. Delving into all factors/facts in full context and detail. Number 1, calories. Number 2, self-conflicting/contradictory Christmas consumption statistics. Number 3, Christmas food waste statistics. Number 4, the Roast Game death toll in both America and Canada. 5, roast preparation time. 6, literal forensic evidence. 7, anatomy and meat choice. 8, the Canadian Roast Game Theory. 9, the real-life example of The Roast Game Theory, also known as Nicholas Justin Emmett. And finally, number 10, The Roast Game Theory itself. Just like what we went over in The Roast Game A Final Look, but in a deeper, longer, and more thorough timeline. The Roast Game, the entire timeline. Coming December 28th through the 31st, 2021. Only from Brian Mullins the Fox Home Entertainment. Get something to eat, get something to drink, sit back, relax, and watch all these four parts before 2022 comes ringing in. Hi everyone, I am Brian Mullins the Fox, and I am going to discover and prove which of these 50 states of the United States of America has the most roast game casualties. How I will calculate to find out is I take the child mortality rate, the population of children in each state separately, take these ratios and percentages into consideration, and literally just add up the numbers. It's that simple. And no, it does not have to represent every single casualty of the roast game. That's not the point of the video. It's just to give an illustration of which state is the deadliest so far. Let's color the US map with bloody colors. Let's just get a quick overview of the child mortality rates of each state in alphabetical order according to the CDC. And now, let the text-to-speech bot do the work for me when it comes to having to read out this shit, because it's long as fuck. Here we go!
Roast game casualties in children. Alabama, 129,444. Alaska, 22,532. Arizona, 188,955. Arkansas, 82,325. California, 1,043,123. Colorado, 146,963. Connecticut, 80,005. Delaware, 23,994. Florida, 500,861. Georgia, 289,643. Hawaii, 37,379. Idaho, 51,110. Illinois, 331,297. Indiana, 183,655. Iowa, 86,070. Kansas, 82,039. Kentucky, 119,912. Louisiana, 132,955. Maine, 27,798. Maryland, 159,606. Massachusetts, 157,700. Michigan, 250,470. Minnesota, 153,849. Mississippi, 81,189. Missouri, 162,028. Montana, 26,805. Nebraska, 57,877. Nevada, 81,316. New Hampshire, 63,906. New Jersey, 515,167. New Mexico, 53,511. New York, 496,455. North Carolina, 267,656. North Dakota, 23,807. Ohio, 303,449. Oklahoma, 113,169. Oregon, 100,213. Pennsylvania, 309,808. Rhode Island, 23,772. South Carolina, 129,130. South Dakota, 26,858. Tennessee, 180,290. Texas, 880,315. Utah, 108,618. Vermont, 12,904. Virginia, 221,582. Washington, 201,033. West Virginia, 41,004. Wisconsin, 146,027. Wyoming, 15,279.
Here we see now the Rose Game Death Toll by Age Group. Under the age of 5 or 1 to 5 years old, the Rose Game Death Toll indicates that within the age group, there were 8,924,862 children under the age of 5 or 1 to 5 years old that were slaughtered for not believing in Christmas. The age of 6 to 11, 2,458,544 children. The age of 12 to 17, 2,442,000 children by law. And last but not least, babies under a year old. 4,742,916 of them. And yes, all that adding up to 18,568,322. The state with the most deaths is obviously California because it's the most densely populated state even as of this year. That's the answer. I am Brian Mullins the Fox, signing out. Have a good day, everybody! Hello everybody, I am Brian Mullins the Fox, and welcome to another video on the Canadian Roast Game. This time we're looking into death toll statistics alongside with demographics within the death toll, gender and race-wise, and which province is the deadliest in Canada. Let's start with two age groups. First, let's start with children under the age of 5. According to Statista, there is a graphic indicating the number of births in Canada from 2001 to 2020. I added up only from 2001 to 2016, just for good measure, and then subtracted by the total yearly Canadian Roast Game death toll, which is 4,529,675, and then got 1,639,012 of the children in Canada that were slaughtered for not believing in Christmas from 1998 to 2016 were under the age of 5 every year. So when it comes to this age group, in total of the past roughly 19 years, 31,141,228 children under the age of 5. So using one of the statistics I used in the original 2019 Canadian Roast Game video, 2,890,663 Canadian children from 5 to 14 were slaughtered for not believing in Christmas in Canada every year during the Canadian Roast Game era. So the second batch out of all of them, and the biggest so far, is 54,922,597 children between 5 to 14. So that means that, of course, the Canadian Roast Game death toll adds up perfectly. Now, let's get into the demographics. First, let's start off with race. So I'm guessing that the vast majority of the deaths were whites. But what about the slimmest minority, Black Canadians? According to Wikipedia, from a 2016 census, there are a total of 1,198,540, or roughly 1.2 million. And according to the official statistics website of Canada, children under 15 years old represented 26.6% of the Black population, while they represented 16.9% of the total population. At the other end of the age spectrum, 7.3% of the Black population were aged 65 years and over, compared to 15.9% of the total population. So that means, as of 2016, 318,812 Black Canadian children were living there. So in spite of all this, white Canadians make up the biggest majority in the death toll by race, by 99.97%, while Blacks, with 2,795,192, with only 0.03% of the total death toll. Let's use another statistic, link in the description. Now, let's analyze by gender. 52% were male and 48% were female. Now, which province is the deadliest? So assuming it's the same with California, the most populated state in America that had the most roast game casualties, it's the same in Canada with Ontario. That's the short and simple answer to which province is the deadliest. Ontario. I knew this video wasn't going to be very long because, unlike America, the Canadian Roast Game death toll is very plain and simple, and it's not as complex as America. I just want to say a few things before I sign out. I'm getting close to 7,000 subscribers, and once we hit that goal, there will be a new intro logo. And then when I hit 7,000 subscribers, I will update my channel banner. Finally, the last message is, I don't know, it could be obvious. I'm Brian Mullins the Fox, signing out. Have a good day. Hello everybody, I am Brian Mullins the Fox, and this is a rant video that will go down in history as a giant life lesson. If you are somebody on the internet, like me, and have run my channel for nearly 3 years. Or if you're someone like ProJared, someone who has run his channel successfully for numerous years, probably a decade or so, you would know for a matter of fact that there would come a time where false accusations, drama, and complete character shaming that you would have to go through being popular on YouTube. Especially when it comes to, you know, political themes and even, you know, surrounding yourself with popular gaming channels like Game Grumps or the sort. So, first example, ProJared. ProJared has been accused of numerous dirty things, like being a pedo, like being a cheater, etc. He cleared his name in a very long, I'm sorry, apology rebuttal video, which I find to be very fitting to rebuke the fucking lies that people of power, especially people within very powerful inbound circles around Game Grumps, around Twitch, around areas like that in general. When someone surrounds himself with a very imbalanced, toxic, immature, and rather profoundly disgusting circle, then there would come a time when your name is dragged through the mud and your reputation has been swept up completely underneath the carpet, which would rightfully piss you off because you've spent all this time building up your brand name. And if you're an original content creator like ProJared back in the day, you were making money off of content that you made yourself under fair use, being transformative enough, giving enough commentary, expressing your opinions, doing the research, etc. That nowadays on YouTube is a very hard thing to do, if not almost impossible, for small content creators. And now, second and last example, the shit surrounding me. Around May of 2018, just after I got my first PC, I started searching for Discord servers to join, because at that time I was new to Discord. And then I stumbled upon Direwolf, this Canadian conservative YouTuber, who had a very shitty Discord server alongside with Vincent Veritas and Clyde. During this time, I temporarily ran this politically satirical series called The Fox. The first episode pretty much satirizing QAnon by saying, "Oh, veterans are pedophiles," even though that's not true. Even though that's not fucking true. QAnoners were saying that all liberals and all Democrats and that were pedophiles. Which is not true, not even in the fucking slightest. There are just only a few that are corrupt. And just like that, there are only a few veterans that are corrupt in the head and are very violent when it comes to domestic violence and shit like that. Then I shat on the BMI satirically by saying in a nutshell that it's not always accurate, and when you're muscular, sort of muscular like me, and the BMI says 30 or 32, that's not entirely accurate. Or, not entirely foolproof. And last but not least, the shit I said about the USSR being a republic. That was the biggest fucking trigger warning to these people in Direwolf's and Vincent Veritas's Discord server. Because I used a few screenshots showing that these communist regimes or countries were republics, and that the USSR itself was also a republic. Even before all that, I used to run another satirical series called Expose Theory, where I satirically shat talk Gordon Ramsay and, funny enough, satirized myself as being a quote-unquote conspiracy theorist to fool other people in believing that I was an actual conspiracy theorist when I wasn't. And the funniest bit about it was when I edited in Winston Churchill's face and made Adolf Hitler and Winston Churchill look like they have the same faces. If some fucking troglodyte still has a photo of that somewhere, I probably might like to see it again because it's funny as hell just to see how people get so fucking ass mad at satire like that. Going back to the heat of the moment, the drama, before the actual giant 2018 roast game drama. So, I decided to leave Direwolf's and Vincent Veritas's Discord server, and then this little loser named Going Gone, who I have not talked to at all for 2 fucking years or so, had this Discord server. And he was using everything satirical I said, every joke that I made or whatnot, and took it seriously. He used that to smear my name, and the giant drama triathlon happened. A drama within a drama within a drama. The first one was the roast game calorie drama. And that was the first drama that spiraled out of control. Over a month after Going Gone basically started it. And then the whole roast game theory drama happened with me, Will Kincaid, Going Gone, EMC-2103, and Star Shadow Wolf. Alongside with the art theft drama that to this day on February 19th, 2021, this fucker hosted an entire shitstorm stream in which, according to one of his viewers back then, was only 30% understandable. You know, I have my old drama videos archived on the Drama Archive. You could literally just search up Brian Mullins the Fox Drama Archive on YouTube and you'll find it. Back then, all that drama was because all the shit that I said, whether or not if I was being satirical or serious, they were trying to find some way to cancel me, make me look bad, and then paint me as someone to be a whole lot shadier than I seem to be in reality, which isn't really shady at all. You know, I was edgy, don't get me wrong, but then I deleted the edgy content so I wouldn't get banned from YouTube. That's why. Because YouTube was getting very, very hard on people who make the conspiracy content on, you know, QAnon and the sort. And to this day, at the very end of that one, on February 28th, 2019, Will Kincaid, this spurg on the internet that talked to people like Britt Keen and such, made an entire abortion rant stream about 4 minutes and 30 seconds long, accusing me of numerous things. First off, he said that I'm a retard and the roast game theory sucks, without giving a direct reason on how and why it sucks, and said that it's so abundant with logical fallacy and logical inconsistency and just absolute dog shit nonsense that nobody can take you seriously. Then he said, "You do shady things," and I'm assuming that he was talking about me writing an Encyclopedia Dramatica about and doxing Esso, which that's not even true, and even they admitted that wasn't true. And I was falsely accused of making money off of art that I don't even fucking own. That was the fucking reason why I spurged out during and at the beginning of the Vashland Set drama just over 2 years ago. Shit like that from 2 years ago seems quite the example to set as a life lesson when it comes to people who will try to cancel you at whatever cost or whatever risk they have to their own reputations. Here's how you learn about not being wrong on drama / false accusations. Don't take anybody's words, screenshots, live streams, or response videos at face value. You come to your own fucking conclusion and just don't say anything until the drama clears up. Because at the end of the day, it's going to really help you reputation-wise, mental health-wise, and strategy-wise. No, this isn't fucking 4D chess. Stop playing this like it's a game. It's not a game because shit like this has real-life consequences that cannot be undone, reversed, or even set aside. You're gonna get canceled one day, and you're gonna have to fucking put your foot down, or else you're fucking done. You're nobody. That's it. It's very hard to be a popular fucking YouTuber. It's very hard to try and learn every single person that I could just even try to consider as friends. It's very hard to live in these fucking crazy social apparatuses to where I can just at least create a circle of my own. It's just retarded that I see people bitch about one thing I said when I was being satirically. They take that shit seriously. It fucking made me blow up in the summer of 2018. And when I was being serious at the end of all this drama, I was also pissed that they weren't taking me seriously. Don't surround yourself with absolute pieces of shit. Don't surround yourself with reactionaries or conservatives or whatnot. Don't associate with people that you don't know enough about. Don't associate yourself with people who will literally use your name to your own detriment. Because at the end of the day, it's gonna seriously bite you square in the ass. and it's going to hurt like a motherfucker. I am Brian Mullins the Fox, signing out. Hello everyone, this video will not be part of the roast game of Final Look, because obviously, I finished that series already. It will premiere in December. Before I begin the commentary segment, I want to say a few things. Firstly, this video is mainly focused on before and after the roast game era. The 1990s was such a decade of upcoming changes, whether if it's technologically, economically, and even statistically viable. I am Brian Mullins the Fox, and welcome to a very interesting new topic of commentary and a rant at the end. Christmas dinner statistics and the holiday tradition in the kitchen before and after the roast game era. First, let's start off with the difference between consumption statistics before and during the roast game era. Starting with before, here is a Kellogg's Special K cereal commercial called Lose the Holiday Fat from 1991, providing a factual statistic that the average American gains an average of 4 to 7 pounds during the holidays, compared to during the roast game era. With both of these consumption statistics from 2015 and 13, it's much less compared to the UK. Let's play the commercial now.
Eggnog, mashed potatoes and gravy, Santa cookies, Aunt Wilma's bunt cake.
The average American
turkey
can gain 4 to 7 pounds during the holidays.
Candy canes,
and you're probably one of them.
Sweet potatoes.
So include the Kellogg's Special K breakfast in your New Year's diet.
Dip.
And get the scale moving in the right direction.
Fruitcake.
Kellogg's Special K. Lose the holiday fat.
What about in the post-roast game era? Here's a survey that can actually be reliable somewhat. This one is by Erica Young. This survey reveals the most popular Christmas dish across America. Making last-minute adjustments to your Christmas menu? Find out which holiday dishes will make spirits bright. We love giving and receiving gifts during the Christmas season, but let's be honest, we're here for the food. From juicy prime rib to grandma's Christmas fudge, everyone has their favorite traditional holiday dish. But have you ever wondered if your family's go-to recipe are popular in kitchens across America? A YouGov poll asked 1,140 people to choose the better of two Christmas foods in a series of head-to-head matchups. The holiday dish that won the most matchups might surprise you. It wasn't turkey or even ham. Remember, Americans love their carbs. This is post-roast game, obviously. The most popular Christmas dishes, the number one pick is roast potatoes, with a win percentage of 76%. The only protein in the top five. Here is the full list. Furthermore, even in 2019, when the roast game was no longer a phenomenon, according to Statista, which dishes are you planning to have on Christmas? 51% said they're planning to have turkey, and 48% plan to have ham as the hallmark of Christmas dinner. In 2019, it's technically post-roast game, but it's before the 2020s. It's before COVID, so yeah. Unsurprisingly, the surveys and even statistics are becoming clear as day as years go by. Americans and Canadians returning back to their would-have-been streak of Christmas dinner tradition, something they've never done since 1997. Now, since all of that is out of the way, here's the rant. It's impossible to mince anyone's words at this point. It's hard to believe how swift people were to go right back to turkey and ham again in 2017, 18, 19, and 2020. It blows my mind, baffles me numb, and dumbfounds me stupid that they would be so deliberate and meticulous with their actions. I can't believe how quick they were to switch back, since it seems almost effortless to do so at this point. Millions of both Americans and Canadians throw every single shank and whole piece of ham and turkey away. They see commercials on the TV for such products and wonder why there's a global pork shortage. You wonder why the history of Christmas dinner is now more checkered than the checkered flag itself. More bad times than good, ever. It really disappoints the hell out of me that anyone with a straight face would possibly tell me that they would never do such a thing. When the complacency is always made apparent, I can never trust a single person at that point to take care of their own children. It really just seems that children don't even matter anymore. Why would you have kids to raise, educate, and send them off into the world around them as adults if the only option since you as an American and even Canadian during the roughly 19-year period of the roast game era is to just downright slaughter them, cut out their back ends, then leave them all alone to bleed, die, decompose, and merely fester and rot as a stain of the existence that would have stood between tradition and humanity. A reminder of what potential was in this child's life. Humanity is meaningless at this point. The smell of death in this situation is nostalgic as fuck and gives me weird and creepy vibes all the fuck over. Like, Jesus fucking Christ. Like, holy shit. Imagine this. Put this into your thicker, hollow fucking skulls for a moment. They've been eating their own children as their Christmas roast for 18 Christmases or roughly 19 years during that period. Americans came back to eating ham or turkey as the hallmark of Christmas dinner again after 20 years. 20 fucking years, ladies and gentlemen. 20 fucking years. Two whole decades since they last held true to their traditions. That is quite shocking. An entire generation of young Americans and Canadians wasted within the complacency and the downright fortitude to not break down and cry. Let all of that sink in. As you cope with your life never being enough for the next generation and wonder to yourself, even if I survived, was it still fucking worth it? What would it take for you to demonstrate to Generation Alpha that their generation is nowhere near in harm's way? There's a fucking pandemic that's about to fucking destroy their lives. It's impacting children. There are Karens out there nosy beyond belief. And schools would still likely be either closed or they will have to learn online. And even when the schools are open, their hours are stifled and cut short. I literally get chills down my spine, my legs, and even down to my ass as I worked so hard to put all of this into perspective within almost 3.5 years, if not 4, by the time the Roast Game of Final Look premieres in December this year. And at this point, I have nothing else to say. I am almost out of breath because I became so passionate. Passionate that my generation has failed me, and the other generation or two failed it before. I am Brian Mullins the Fox, signing out. Hello everyone, I am Brian Mullins the Fox, and by popular demand, I will rant about what to expect after the Roast Game of Final Look premieres, or after Christmas Day this year. Later on this week, probably heading into this weekend, I'll make an extra rant about the Derek Chauvin trial and the verdict, and my thoughts and opinions about the whole matter. Also, I want to update you guys that I merely have a sore arm due to the recent Moderna COVID vaccine that I just got. This is the first shot, and by next month, I'll have my second dose. Without further ado, let's get on to the main topic of the video, shall we? There will be about 3 things that are the most likely to happen. Number one, some cases, if not all of them that I investigated, reemerge, but no arrests are made in correlation to what happened to them. Two, some cases, if not all of them that I discovered, and much more, reemerge, and every case has the potential quote-unquote killer parent arrested merely for the murder and not for the cannibalism. Or three, all of them reemerge, then proven to be 100% legit, beyond a shadow of a doubt, and all hell will break loose in society, not just on the internet, but in real life as well. Here is how I will react to each of those three scenarios. Number one, I won't be surprised, because that will be the single moment that the roast game theory in general and in essence will be rendered completely valid, years after it's been confirmed by me. After achieving success at that point, however, I will only feel a temporary sense of redemption and happiness, but then cope and cry afterwards. Number two, I won't be surprised, but I will be pissed, and this will not be part of the same discussion I had for, by the end of this year, 4 fucking years. Then I will celebrate the same feelings and do the same thing as described in the previous scenario. Or, number three, I will be scared shitless and have to go through the numerous stages of cope, then mentally recover like I did before starting this very channel in the first place, almost 4 years ago, by the time the Roast Game of Final Look premieres. I would gain a whole lot of notoriety, fame, and even some hate up and down the social and political aisle, but I would feel completely accomplished in life. Anything else other than those three scenarios would render the entire concept of resurfacing these cases completely unnecessary, but well-deserved. It would outrage the public out of decency policing, spite, and even complete derision, but they don't give a fuck about children, right? They're just people. It's not about them, it's about children. Not all of these quote-unquote killer parents would be arrested and sent to prison. Some won't have to at this point, because it's been decades after the fact. That's all I have to say for now. This will be the second to last roast game rant that I will ever have to post, because there's just nothing left at this point. The last one will be made on October 20th, which marks the 4th anniversary of the first roast game debate. And most certainly, a lot of roast game related events will happen on this channel, such as the 4th and final season of the long run series called The Roast Game Theory, and the Roast Game of Final Look, of course. Let them all premiere, and by the end of this year, the then-to-be 4-year-long conversation / discussion will be over. I'm Brian Mullins the Fox, signing out. Stay tuned for my Derek Show and rant. It probably won't be long, either. Bye-bye.
Hello everybody, I am Detective Brian Mullins the Fox.
and welcome to the fourth and final season of The Roast Game Theory. Before I go into any further case, I will introduce you several things. Number one, we'll start off with theoretical and investigative factors and tactics from season three, like determining the height, the age of the child, and the weight of a boy or girl and his or her butt meat. Number two, I only have 25 cases left to investigate, and after that, I would have investigated 100 total cases. Yes, it took me years. Rome wasn't built in a day or destroyed in one. Number three, the promos after episodes will be epic. Number four, I will try to find more soundtrack music to make season four a spectacular one. Number five, the finale will be a two-parter. I've explained it before and I don't want to repeat myself. And number six, parody logos are making a swift comeback, bringing back the nostalgia of season two, mixing it in with the seasonal vibes of season three. Alrighty, those were things I want to introduce to you before we begin our final journey on the next episode of Season 4 of The Roast Game Theory. I am Detective Brian Mullins the Fox, signing out. See you then. Hello everybody, I am Detective Brian Mullins the Fox, and welcome to Season 4, Case 1 of The Roast Game Theory. The home that we are about to look into is 4787 Carr Road in Columbus, Ohio. This house has 3 bedrooms, 2 bathrooms, 1,384 square feet of space, and was built in 1963. The name of the child is Bricker Leonardo Jalen. He was 7 years old, born on March 6th, 1995, and died on July 31st, 2002. November 17th, 1998, from now on, being the middle marker. I introduce to you the middle marker rule. He was 57.3 inches tall, above average. His total weight was 47.5 pounds. The weight of his Christmas butt meat was over 1 1/3 pounds. The total caloric amount in which is 3,040 calories. It served 7 people on average, 9.2 people without sides, and 4.6 with sides, adding up to about 21 total servings. Now, some people went for seconds. God damn. And finally, on the Christmas of 2002, his butt meat was defrosted, seasoned, cooked for several hours, sides were being prepared, and it was finally served with the sides on Christmas Day evening. Well, that does it for the first step out of the 25 to go until the holy grail of finales. We have only 24 steps to go. We'll start doing the big countdowns when we have 15 cases left of the season and of the series. I am Detective Brian Mullins the Fox, signing out, and do be safe, my furries.
Oh,
Hello, everybody. I am Detective Brian Mullins the Fox, and welcome to Season 4, Case 2 of The Roast Game Theory. The house that I'm about to investigate is 6742 Wanamaker Drive in Reynoldsburg, Ohio. This house has 3 bedrooms, 2 bathrooms, 1,404 square feet of space, and was built in 1960. The identity of this child is 2-year-old Owen Henley Bellamy. He was born on August 14th, 1997, and died on February 20th, 2000. His height was 35.4 inches tall, above average. His total weight was 30 pounds, also above average. The weight of this child's Christmas butt meat is roughly 1 pound. The total caloric amount in which is 1,920 calories. It served 9 people on average, 12 people without sides, and 6 people with sides, with a total of 26 total servings. And finally, on the Christmas of 2000, this child's Christmas butt meat, which was preserved in the freezer for months, was defrosted, seasoned, put in the oven, roasted, the sides alongside with the butt meat prepared, and his butt meat was finally prepared with the other sides to his family as their Christmas roast. That will do it for Season 4, Case 2 of The Roast Game Theory. By the end of Case 5, we will leave the winter seasonal vibe and enter into the spring. I am Detective Brian Mullins the Fox, signing out. See you in Season 4, Case Number 3. Bye. Hello, everybody. I am Detective Brian Mullins the Fox, and welcome to Season 4, Case 3 of The Roast Game Theory. The house that I'm about to investigate is 107 West 4th Street in Sugar Grove, Ohio. This house has 3 bedrooms, 2 bathrooms, 1,056 square feet of space, and was built in 1966. The identity of this child is 5-year-old Thomas Howard Jason. He was born on May 7th, 1996, and died on May 29th, 2001. His height was 43 inches tall, and his weight in total was 40.5 pounds, just about the average. The weight of this child's Christmas butt meat is just over a pound. The total caloric amount in which is 2,592 calories. It served 6 people on average, 8 people without sides, and 4 with sides, bringing in a total of 18 total servings. And finally, on the Christmas of 2001, it happened. The usual process: defrosting, seasoning, cooking, preparing sides alongside with the butt meat, and then finally the consumption. I am Detective Brian Mullins the Fox. See you in Season 4, Case 4, which I will announce at the end of that episode. The departure from the winter seasonal vibe and the transition into the spring seasonal vibe. Bye.
Yeah.
Hello, everybody. It is I, Detective Brian Mullins the Fox, and welcome to Season 4, Case 4 of The Roast Game Theory. The house that I am about to investigate is 1424 Kirkland Avenue in Nashville, Tennessee. This house has two bedrooms, two bathrooms, 1,750 square feet of space, and a basement, which was built in 1963. The identity of this child is 5-year-old Bianca Chevelle Faith. She was born on April 14th, 1996, and died on June 21st, 2001. She was about 44 and a half inches tall, and she weighed 41 and a half pounds. The weight of her Christmas butt meat was roughly 1.2 pounds. The total caloric amount in which is 2,656 calories. It served 6 people on average, 8 people without sides, and 4 people with sides, with a total of 18 total servings. And finally, on the Christmas of 2001, it happened. Defrosted, seasoned, cooked, with sides prepared, and was finally dished out on the night of that Christmas in 2001. Well, that does it. Season 4, Case 4 of The Roast Game Theory. We are no longer in the winter seasonal vibe. Get ready, because this also means there will be a parody logo change every time a seasonal vibe changes. Bye now. I'm gonna shut off my winter fur. Hello, everybody. It is I, Detective Brian Mullins the Fox, with my winter fur shed it off. Woohoo! It feels nice being in the spring seasonal vibe and such. Welcome to Season 4, Case 5 of The Roast Game Theory. The house that I'm about to investigate is 6676 Beach Fork Road in Barboursville, West Virginia. This house has 3 bedrooms, 1 bathroom, 1,444 square feet of space, and was built in 1958. The identity of this child is 2-year-old Charles Gary Godwin. He was born on August 14th, 1997, and died on February 20th, 2000. He was 36.8 inches tall, and his total weight was 30.1 pounds, and the total weight of this child's Christmas butt meat is roughly 1 pound. The total caloric amount in which is 1,926 calories. It served 4.4 people on average, 3 people without sides and 6 people with sides, bringing a total serving of 13.4 total servings. And finally, on the Christmas of 2000, it happened. His butt meat was defrosted, seasoned, put in the oven, cooked, with sides prepared, and was finally dished out on the night of that Christmas day in 2000. Well, that'll do it for Season 4, Case 5 of The Roast Game Theory. I am Detective Brian Mullins the Fox, signing out. I'm still recovering from that huge sigh of relief from shedding off all that winter fur. It'll take a long time, I'm sure. Hello, everybody. It is I, Detective Brian Mullins the Fox, and welcome to Season 4, Case 6 of The Roast Game Theory. The house that I am about to investigate is 4550 Old Town Drive in Winston-Salem, North Carolina. This house has 4 bedrooms, 2 bathrooms, 1,935 square feet of space, and was built in 1955. The identity of this child is 11-year-old Victoria Jennifer Christina. She was born on Saturday, March 20th, 1993, and died on Friday, July 16th, 2004. She was roughly 61 inches tall, and she weighed at a total of 85.5 pounds. And finally, the weight of this girl's Christmas butt meat is roughly 2.5 pounds. The total caloric amount in which is 5,472 calories. It served 12.4 people on average, 16.5 with sides, and 8.3 without sides, with a total of 37.2 total servings. And finally, on the Christmas of 2004, 11-year-old Victoria Jennifer Christina had her butt meat defrosted, seasoned, cooked, and served as a side dish with all the other sides on the night of that Christmas day in 2004. Well, that does it for Season 4, Case 6 of The Roast Game Theory. It has been Detective Brian Mullins the Fox, signing out. See you on the next episode. Bye. Hello, everybody. I am Detective Brian Mullins the Fox, and welcome to Season 4, Case 7 of The Roast Game Theory. The house that I'm about to investigate is 1510 Indian Hill Drive in Schaumburg, Illinois. This house has 3 bedrooms, 2 bathrooms, 1,171 square feet of space, and was built in 1960. Incredibly, just about 6 decades ago. The identity of this child is 5-year-old Peter Henley Emanuel. He was born on Friday, May 10th, 1996, and died on Saturday, May 26th, 2001. He was 43 inches tall, and he weighed at a total of 40.5 pounds. The weight of this boy's Christmas butt meat is roughly around 1 pound. The total caloric amount in which is 2,592 calories. It served 6 people on average, 8 with sides, and 4 without sides, adding up to 18 total servings. The average amount of servings per person is 2. And finally, on the Christmas of 2001, Peter's butt meat was defrosted, seasoned, cooked, served as a side dish, and consumed by his family as their Christmas roast for not believing in Christmas. Well, that does it for Season 4, Case 7 of The Roast Game Theory. We only have one more full episode in the spring seasonal vibe to go until we hit the beaches in the summer seasonal vibe. Heads up! There won't be too much blood in the pool, hopefully if you're not a carnivore. I am Detective Brian Mullins the Fox, signing out. See you then. Hello everybody, it is I, Detective Brian Mullins the Fox, and welcome to Season 4, Case 8 of The Roast Game Theory. And during the production of this season, I am fact-checking all the slaughterhouses I've investigated in Season 1 of The Roast Game Theory. And the house that I'm about to investigate now is 695 State Route 380 in Murrysville, Pennsylvania. This house has 4 bedrooms, 2 bathrooms, 1,400 square feet of space, and was built in 1958. The identity of this child is 5-year-old Felix Gary Gunner. He was born on Friday, May 10th, 1996, and died on Saturday, May 26th, 2001. So coincidentally, his height, his total weight, the weight of his butt meat, the total caloric amount in which, the servings, total on average without sides, with sides, and per person is about the same as the last case. So I'm saying it in simpler terms just to spare you the time. And finally, on the Christmas of 2001, just like the previous case, defrosted, seasoned, then cooked, and finally, the butt meat was served to his family as their Christmas roast. Now, before I sign out, I want to make a couple things clear. First and foremost, here is how the Season 4 finale is truly gonna go. I will fact check and make sure if every house I've investigated during the entire series of The Roast Game Theory has no contradictory criminal records or any blood stain or slaughter that connects to any other crime. It would only confirm this theory in this series if it looks like a child was slaughtered or murdered or disemboweled, you know, and it doesn't attach to any other crime or anything else that contradicts this theory, then this theory is confirmed. I am Detective Brian Mullins the Fox, signing out. Let's leave the spring seasonal vibe together, shall we? See you then. Hello everybody, I am Detective Brian Mullins the Fox, and welcome to Season 4, Case 9 of The Roast Game Theory. The house that I'm about to investigate is 700 North Fox Hunter Road in Fayetteville, Arkansas. This house has 4 bedrooms, 2 bathrooms, 3,385 square feet of space, and was built in 1955. The identity of this child is 3-year-old Venus Andromeda Myrna. She was born on Tuesday, April 22nd, 1997, and died on Tuesday, June 13th, 2000. Her height was 41.1 inches tall. Her total weight was 35.6 pounds. The weight of her Christmas butt meat is just about a pound. The total caloric amount in which is 2,278 calories, serving a total of 15.5 people. 5.2 people on average, 3.5 people without sides, and 7 people with sides. The average amount of servings per person is 3, given that this butt meat is merely a side dish, not the main course. And finally, on the Christmas of 2000, her butt meat was defrosted, seasoned, cooked, served with sides, and consumed by her family as their Christmas roast. Well, that does it for Season 4, Case 9 of The Roast Game Theory. I am Detective Brian Mullins the Fox, signing out. See you then. Its inception was imminent. The comeback was inevitable. Then the continuance was phenomenal. After 3 years and 3 entire seasons, this one will be final. Now, with 15 cases to go of not just the 4th season, but the rest of this series as well. The 2-parter finale, part 1 will be the season finale, and the second, the series finale. The same conclusion will be drawn, but with the substantive context and evidence. At the end of the day, whether or not if you specifically are innocent or not is irrelevant. If you have kids, young and old, or rather less than you had before, know your role. Being an angel up in heaven drinking the blood of Christ does not make you any less satanic than the devil himself. Kneeling and praying to God does not make you any less non-existent as an influence on your children than a neglectful one on yourself. Being morally superior, literally or not, does not make your hands any less dirty. Caring for children does not make you any less of a monster. Losing a child's life is no more or less valuable than losing your own. Know your role, find the golden key, and open the door to the room of a loving darkness. And in that same room, unlike Satan, God will be there with you. We'll be right back. Hello, everybody. It is I, Detective Brian Mullins the Fox. Welcome to Season 4, Case 10 of The Roast Game Theory. We have 15 cases to go. Alrighty, let's continue. The home address is 4917 Lila Avenue in Louisville, Kentucky. How odd. When I'm recording this, there's shit going on in Louisville, Kentucky. This house has 3 bedrooms, 2 bathrooms, 1,157 square feet of space, and was built in 1956. The identity of this child is 3-year-old Nigel Quentin Falcon. He was born on Monday, April 21st, 1997, and died on Wednesday, June 14th, 2000. His height was 41.8 inches tall. His total weight was 35.3 pounds. And the weight of Nigel's Christmas butt meat is just about 1 pound. The total caloric amount in which his 2,259 calories is served a total of 10.3 people, 2 servings per person. It fed 5 people on average, roughly 7 people without sides, and 3.4 with sides. And finally, on Christmas Day 2000, his butt meat was defrosted, seasoned, cooked, the sides were prepared, and finally, his family got to eat his literal ass as the centerpiece of their Christmas dinner on that day in 2000 as their Christmas roast for not believing in Christmas. Well, that does it for Season 4, Case 10 of The Roast Game Theory. I am Detective Brian Mullins the Fox signing out. See you then. Its inception was imminent. The comeback was inevitable. Then the continuance was phenomenal. After over 3 years and 3 entire seasons, this one will be final. Now with less than 15 cases to go of not just the 4th season, but the rest of the series as well. The 2-parter finale. Part 1 will be the season finale, and the 2nd, the series finale. The same conclusion will be drawn, but with the substantive context and evidence. At the end of the day, whether or not if you specifically are innocent or not is irrelevant. If you have kids, young and old, or rather less than you had before, know your role. Being an angel up in heaven drinking the blood of Christ does not make you any less satanic than the devil himself. Kneeling and praying to God does not make you any less non-existent as an influence on your children than a neglectful one on yourself. Being morally superior, literally or not, does not make your hands any less dirty. Caring for children does not make you any less of a monster. Losing a child's life is no more or less valuable than losing your own. Know your role, find the golden key, and open the door to the room of a loving darkness. And in that same room, unlike Satan, God will be there with you. Hello, everybody. It is I, Detective Brian Mullins the Fox, and welcome to Season 4, Case 11 of The Roast Game Theory. The home address is 449 Crestview Drive in Lebanon, Ohio. This house has three bedrooms, two bathrooms, 1,377 square feet of space, and was built in 1957. The name of the child is Willow Queenie Melody. She was born on Monday, April 21st, 1997, and died on Wednesday, June 14th, 2000. Her height was 41.3 inches tall, and her total weight was 35.8 pounds. The weight of Willow's Christmas butt meat is just about a pound. The total caloric amount in which is 2,291 calories. It served a total of 10.4 people, two servings per person. 5.2 people on average, roughly 7 people without sides, and 3.5 people with sides. And finally, on Christmas Day 2000, her butt meat was defrosted, seasoned, cooked, served with sides, and consumed by her family as their Christmas roast after slaughtering her for not believing in Christmas. Well, that does it for Season 4, Case 11 of The Roast Game Theory. I am Detective Brian Mullins the Fox, signing out. See you then. Its inception was imminent. The comeback was inevitable. Then the continuance was phenomenal. After over 3 years and three entire seasons, this one will be final. Now with less than 15 cases to go of not just the fourth season, but the rest of the series as well. The two-parter finale. Part one will be the season finale, and the second, the series finale. The same conclusion will be drawn, but with the substantive context and evidence. At the end of the day, whether or not if you specifically are innocent or not is irrelevant. If you have kids, young and old, or rather less than you had before, know your role. Being an angel up in heaven drinking the blood of Christ does not make you any less satanic than the devil himself. Kneeling and praying to God does not make you any less non-existent as an influence on your children than a neglectful one on yourself. Being morally superior, literally or not, does not make your hands any less dirty. Caring for children does not make you any less of a monster. Losing a child's life is no more or less valuable than losing your own. Know your role, find the golden key, and open the door to the room of a loving darkness. And in that same room, unlike Satan, God will be there with you. Thank you. Hello everybody, it is I, Detective Brian Mullins the Fox, and welcome to Season 4, Case 12 of The Roast Game Theory. The house that I'm about to investigate is 1530 Ravinia Road in Charleston, West Virginia. This house has 3 bedrooms, 2 bathrooms, 1,508 square feet of space, and was built in 1962. The identity of this child is 2-year-old Chloe Priyanka Dottie. She was born on Monday, July 14th, 1997, and died on Wednesday, March 22nd, 2000. Her height was 37.1 inches tall. Her total weight was roughly 30 pounds, or 29.9 pounds. The weight of Chloe's Christmas bought meat is roughly a pound. The total caloric amount in which is roughly 1,914 calories. It served a total of 9 people, 2 servings per person. On average, it served roughly 4.4 people, 6 people without sides, and 3 people with sides. And finally, on the Christmas of 2000, they defrosted her meat, seasoning it after defrosting it, then cooking it, and then prepared alongside with all the other side dishes on that very special day to them as their Christmas roast for not believing in Christmas. And that is gonna do it for Season 4, Case 12 of The Roast Game Theory. We only have 13 cases to go until it's all over. Yes, the final case included. Don't get your math mixed up. I am Detective Brian Mullins the Fox, signing out. See you then. Its inception was imminent. The comeback was inevitable. Then the continuance was phenomenal. After over 3 years and 3 entire seasons, this one will be final. Now with less than 15 cases to go of not just the 4th season, but the rest of the series as well. The 2-parter finale. Part 1 will be the season finale, and the 2nd, the series finale. The same conclusion will be drawn, but with the substantive context and evidence. At the end of the day, whether or not if you specifically are innocent or not is irrelevant. If you have kids, young and old, or rather less than you had before, know your role. Being an angel up in heaven drinking the blood of Christ does not make you any less satanic than the devil himself. Kneeling and praying to God does not make you any less non-existent as an influence on your children than a neglectful one on yourself. Being morally superior, literally or not, does not make your hands any less dirty. Caring for children does not make you any less of a monster. Losing a child's life is no more or less valuable than losing your own. Know your role, find the golden key, and open the door to the room of a loving darkness. And in that same room, unlike Satan, God will be there with you. Hello, everybody. It is I, Detective Brian Mullins the Fox, and welcome to Season 4, Case 13 of the Roast Game Theory. The house that I'm about to look into is 3808 Bonita Road in Columbus, Ohio. This house has 3 bedrooms, 2 bathrooms, 1,510 square feet of space, and was built in 1963. The identity of this child is 5-year-old Dominic Harris Benjamin. He was born on Wednesday, May 8th, 1996, and died on Monday, May 28th, 2001. His height was 43 inches tall. His total weight was 40.5 pounds. The weight of Dominic's Christmas butt meat is just around 1 pound. The total caloric amount in which is 2,592 calories. It served a total of roughly 12 people, 2 servings per person, roughly 6 people on average, roughly 8 people without sides, and roughly 4 people with sides. And finally, on the Christmas of 2001, Dominic's Christmas butt meat, after being in the freezer for so long, was defrosted, seasoned, prepared for the oven, put in the oven for a certain period of time, cooked, served with side dishes. After all those other side dishes have been properly cooked and prepared, and they ate Christmas dinner after slaughtering that child for not believing in Christmas. And that will do it for Season 4, Case 13 of the Roast Game Theory. I am your host, Detective Brian Mullins the Fox. Before I sign out, by Case 15 this season, we will no longer be in the summer seasonal vibe. We will start in cooler weather. Let's hope for the best in the fall seasonal vibe ahead. I'm signing out now. See you then. Its inception was imminent. The comeback was inevitable. Then the continuance was phenomenal. After over 3 years and 3 entire seasons, this one will be final. Now with less than 15 cases to go of not just the 4th season, but the rest of the series as well. The 2-parter finale. Part 1 will be the season finale, and the 2nd, the series finale. The same conclusion will be drawn, but with the substantive context and evidence. At the end of the day, whether or not if you specifically are innocent or not is irrelevant. If you have kids, young and old, or rather less than you had before, know your role. Being an angel up in heaven drinking the blood of Christ does not make you any less satanic than the devil himself. Kneeling and praying to God does not make you any less non-existent as an influence on your children than a neglectful one on yourself. Being morally superior, literally or not, does not make your hands any less dirty. Caring for children does not make you any less of a monster. Losing a child's life is no more or less valuable than losing your own. Know your role, find the golden key, and open the door to the room of a loving darkness. And in that same room, unlike Satan, God will be there with you. Hello everybody, it is I, Detective Brian Mullins the Fox, and welcome to Season 4, Case 14 of The Roast Game Theory. The house that I'm about to investigate is 546 Dixie Drive in Mooresville, North Carolina. This house has 3 bedrooms, 2 bathrooms, 1,258 square feet of space, and was built in 1970. The identity of this child is 2-year-old October Portia Desire. She was born on Friday, July 11th, 1997, and died on Saturday, March 25th, 2000. Her height was 37.2 inches tall. Her total weight was 30 pounds. The weight of October's Christmas butt meat is roughly 1 pound. The total caloric amount in which is 1,920 calories. It served a total of roughly 9 people. That's roughly 9 servings in total. 2 servings per person. It served 4.4 people on average. Roughly 3 people without sides, and roughly 6 people with sides. And finally, on the Christmas of 2000, it happened. Her butt meat was defrosted, seasoned, cooked, alongside with the side dishes. After being roasted in the oven, it was dished out and consumed by her family as their Christmas roast, after slaughtering her for not believing in Christmas. Well, that'll do it for Season 4, Case 14 of The Roast Game Theory. After this, we have 10 more cases to go until the final season in cases is complete before the finale. See you then. It began with Season 1, then the series revived itself with Season 2, then it continued through Season 3. The journey is not over yet, with Season 4. You know which way to go, straight ahead. Now we have 10 cases to go, until the finale arrives. Until the raison d'etre of the entire series comes forward with the most potent be-all end-all, the truth. The whole truth, and nothing but the truth. Come hell or high water this September. The Roast Game Theory's 2-part finale spectacular. The bloody evidence, the numbers, and the true horror behind it all. Coming September 3rd and 5th, 2021. Only from Brian Mullins the Fox. Brace yourselves. May God have mercy on your soul. Stay tuned. Stay very, very tuned. Hello, everybody. It is I, Detective Brian Mullins the Fox, and welcome to Season 4, Case 15 of The Roast Game Theory, the 90th case so far throughout this entire series. The home that I'm about to investigate is 436 67th Street, Southwest, Albuquerque, New Mexico. This home has three bedrooms, one bathroom, 900 square feet of space, and was built in 1961. The identity of this child is 5-year-old Rodrigo Gustavo Nicodemus. He was born on Thursday, May 9th, 1996, and died on Sunday, May 27th, 2001. His height was 43 inches tall. His total weight was 40 and a half pounds. The weight of this boy's Christmas butt meat is just around a pound. The total caloric amount in which is 2,592 calories. It served a total of roughly 12 people, 2 servings per person, 6 people on average, 8 people without sides, and 4 people with sides. Y finalmente, en la Navidad de 2001, su carne de trasero fue descongelada, sazonada, cocinada, y finalmente servida como un plato secundario y consumida por su familia, como su tostada navideña, después de matarlo por no correr en la Navidad. Cultural appropriation! Sorry if I sort of butchered the Spanish here. Just wanted to do something a little different here, because I think this may or may not be the first Latino child that I've discovered that was slaughtered for not believing in Christmas. So, if I sort of butchered the Spanish, let me know. If I didn't, well, that's okay. Well, that is gonna do it for Season 4, Case 15 of The Roast Game Theory. Check out this new teaser promo, and boy howdy, will you be amazed at what I'm about to show you. See ya then. Now, Season 4 is about to end in less than 10 cases and episodes. A storm is coming. There will be blood hurricanes, a Christmas tree-nado, and even a cursed Santa Claus. The math is the math, the facts are the facts. The same conclusion will be drawn, but in a more realistic, more colorful way. There will be hell to pay. Come finale time. The Roast Game Theory's 2-part finale spectacular. Bringing your blood to the screen, September 3rd and 5th, 2021, only from Brian Mullins the Fox. Brace yourselves. May God have mercy on your souls. And stay tuned. Stay very, very tuned. Thank you. Hello, everybody. I am Detective Brian Mullins the Fox, and welcome to Season 4, Case 16 of The Roast Game Theory. The house that I'm about to investigate is 110 Briardale Avenue in Warner Robins, Georgia. This house has 3 bedrooms, 2 bathrooms, 1,100 square feet of space, and was built in 1959. The identity of this child is 2-year-old Brock Philip DeMarcus. He was born on Monday, July 14th, 1997, and died on Wednesday, March 22nd, 2000. His height was 37.7 inches tall, his total weight was 31 pounds, and the weight of Brock's Christmas butt meat is roughly a pound. The total caloric amount in which is 1,984 calories. It served a total of roughly 9 people, 2 servings per person, 4.5 people on average, 3 people without sides, and 6 people with sides. And finally, on the Christmas of 2000, his butt meat was defrosted, seasoned, cooked, and finally served as his family's Christmas roast after slaughtering him for not believing in Christmas. And that is gonna do it for Season 4, Case 16 of The Roast Game Theory. I'm your host, Detective Brian Mullins the Fox, signing out. See you then. Season 4 is about to end in less than 10 cases and episodes. A storm is coming. There will be blood hurricanes, a Christmas tree nato, and even a cursed Santa Claus. The math is the math, the facts are the facts. The same conclusion will be drawn, but in a more realistic, more colorful way. There will be hell to pay. Come finale time. The Roast Game Theory's 2-part finale spectacular. Bringing your blood to the screen, September 3rd and 5th, 2021. Only from Brian Mullins the Fox. Brace yourselves. May God have mercy on your souls. And stay tuned. Stay very, very tuned. Hello everyone, it is I, Detective Brian Mullins the Fox, and welcome to Season 4, Case 17 of The Roast Game Theory. The house that I'm about to investigate is 1201 Green Lawn Drive in Norfolk, Nebraska. This house has 3 bedrooms, 3 bathrooms, 2,150 square feet of space, and was built in 1964. The identity of this child is 2-year-old O'Neill Patrick Niccolo. He was born on Monday, July 14th, 1997, and died on Wednesday, March 22nd, 2000. Wow, some children in this season of The Roast Game Theory have the same date of birth and date of death. Somehow coincidental. Or maybe not. Maybe it's just that children are born and have died the same day as other children. Who knows? His height was 37.7 inches tall. His total weight is 31 pounds, and the weight of O'Neill's Christmas butt meat, as usual, is roughly a pound. The total caloric amount in which is 1,984 calories. It served a total of roughly 9 people, 2 servings per person, 4.5 people on average, 3 people without sides, and 6 people with sides. And finally, on the Christmas of 2000, his butt meat was defrosted, seasoned, cooked, prepared, then served as his family's Christmas roast after slaughtering him for not believing in Christmas. Well, that'll do it for Season 4, Case 17 of The Roast Game Theory. I'm your host, Detective Brian Mullins the Fox, signing out. We're getting close to that winter feeling again. Ooh, and I can feel my winter fur growing back again. Thank fucking God summer's over. Now, Season 4 is about to end in less than 10 cases and episodes. A storm is coming. There will be blood hurricanes, a Christmas tree-nado, and even a cursed Santa Claus. The math is the math, the facts are the facts. The same conclusion will be drawn, but in a more realistic, more colorful way. There will be hell to pay. Come finale time. The Roast Game Theory's 2-part finale spectacular. Bringing your blood to the screen, September 3rd and 5th, 2021, only from Brian Mullins the Fox. Brace yourselves. May God have mercy on your souls. And stay tuned. Stay very, very tuned. everybody, it is I, Detective Brian Mullins the Fox. Before I begin, there seems to be a trend that's starting in this season of The Roast Game Theory. Less screenshots means that we have already found the trend before the finale, and it comports with reality. And I guess it matches perfectly. Welcome to Season 4, Case 18 of The Roast Game Theory. The house that I'm about to investigate is 2012 Merrill Street in Bellewitt, Wisconsin. This house has 3 bedrooms, 1 bathroom, 1,603 square feet of space, and was built in 1964. The identity of this child is 2-year-old Cullen Richard Reeve. He was born on Sunday, September 14th, 1997, and died on Thursday, January 20th, 2000. His height was 36.4 inches tall. The total weight is 29.7 pounds. And the weight of his Christmas butt meat is roughly a pound. The total caloric amount in which is roughly 1,914 calories. It served a total of roughly 9 people, 2 servings per person, 4.4 people on average, 6 people without sides, and 3 people with sides. And finally, on the Christmas of 2000, it happened. His butt meat was defrosted, seasoned, cooked, prepared, dished out, and consumed by his family as their Christmas roast, after slaughtering him for not believing in Christmas. Well, that will do it for Season 4, Case 18 of The Roast Game Theory. Next episode, we will be in the winter seasonal vibe all over again. It's like winter came in a little early. I am Detective Brian Mullins the Fox, signing out. Bye-bye. Now, Season 4 is about to end in less than 10 cases and episodes. A storm is coming. There will be blood hurricanes, a Christmas tree-nado, and even a cursed Santa Claus. The math is the math, the facts are the facts. The same conclusion will be drawn, but in a more realistic, more colorful way. There will be hell to pay come finale time. The Roast Game Theory's 2-part finale spectacular. Bringing your blood to the screen, September 3rd and 5th, 2021, only from Brian Mullins the Fox. Brace yourselves. May God have mercy on your souls. And stay tuned. Stay very, very tuned. Hello, everybody. It is I, Detective Brian Mullins the Fox, and welcome to Season 4, Case 19 of The Roast Game Theory. Welcome to the winter seasonal vibe. The house that I'm about to investigate is 108 Tabor Drive in Columbia, South Carolina. This house has 3 bedrooms, 1 bathroom, 1,043 square feet of space, and was built in 1958. The identity of this child is 7-year-old Bruno Boone Jackson. He was born on Monday, February 20th, 1995, and died on Wednesday, August 14th, 2002. His height was 51 inches tall. He weighed at a total of 53.5 pounds. The weight of his butt meat is just around 1.5 pounds. The total caloric amount in which 3,424 calories. It fed a total of roughly 16 people, 2 servings per person, 7.8 people on average, 5.2 people without sides, and 10.4 people with sides. And finally, on the Christmas of 2002, it happened. His butt meat was defrosted, seasoned, cooked, prepared, dished out, served, and finally consumed as his family's Christmas roast after slaughtering him for not believing in Christmas. Well, that'll do it for Season 4, Case 19 of The Roast Game Theory. I am Brian Mullins the Fox, signing out. Enjoy the winter seasonal vibes' beautiful entrance. It began with Season 1, then the series revived itself with Season 2, then it continued with Season 3. Now with 5 cases to go, we are in the home stretch of the entire series. 5 more cases until the Roast Game Theory 2-part finale spectacular. After each case has been fully expanded upon, I will then collect the data and make statistics. These statistics will corroborate the child's racial, religious, and family background. The percentage of the suspects separated by gender, race, and religion. For example, what do you think is the percentage of the children that were slaughtered for not believing in Christmas are black, white, were raised by a single mother, a single father, or a complete family? At that point, your guess is as good as mine. Nobody knows. Stick around and you'll find out. The Roast Game Theory 2-part finale spectacular, coming September 3rd and 5th, 2021. Brace yourselves. We'll be right back. Hello, it is I, Detective Brian Mullins the Fox, and welcome to Season 4, Case 20 of The Roast Game Theory. The house that I'm about to investigate is 4998 Village Road in Cookeville, Tennessee. This home has 3 bedrooms, 1 bathroom, 1,200 square feet of space, and was built in 1962. The identity of this child is 3-year-old Lincoln Finnegan Ivanhoe. He was born on Wednesday, January 22nd, 1997, and died on Monday, September 11th, 2000. His height was 37.4 inches tall. His total weight was 30.7 pounds. The weight of his Christmas butt meat is roughly a pound. The total caloric amount in which is 1,965 calories. It served a total of roughly 9 people. Roughly 4.5 people on average, roughly 3 people without sides, and roughly 6 people with sides. And finally, on the Christmas of 2000, it happened. His butt meat was defrosted, seasoned, cooked, then consumed as their family's Christmas roast after slaughtering him for not believing in Christmas. Well, that is gonna do it for Season 4, Case 20 of The Roast Game Theory. I am your host, Detective Brian Mullins the Fox, signing out. Now we have less than 5 cases to go, and things will only get more epic as each case goes by. See you then. It began with Season 1, then the series revived itself with Season 2, then it continued with Season 3. Now with less than 5 cases to go, we are in the home stretch of the entire series. 5 more cases until the Roast Game Theory 2-part finale spectacular. After each case has been fully expanded upon, I will then collect the data and make statistics. These statistics will corroborate the child's racial, religious, and family background. The percentage of the suspects separated by gender, race, and religion. For example, what do you think is the percentage of the children that were slaughtered for not believing in Christmas are black, white, were raised by a single mother, a single father, or a complete family? At that point, your guess is as good as mine. Nobody knows. Stick around and you'll find out. The Roast Game Theory 2-part finale spectacular, coming September 3rd and 5th, 2021. Brace yourselves. May God have mercy on your soul. May Santa consume himself with the blood of 1,000 children he consumed before. And most importantly, stay tuned. Stay very, very tuned. We'll be right back. Hi everybody, it is I, Detective Brian Mullins the Fox, and welcome to Season 4, Case 21 of The Roast Game Theory. The house that I'm about to investigate is 3736 Lock Lane in North Little Rock, Arkansas. This home has 3 bedrooms, 2 bathrooms, 1,776 square feet of space, and was built in 1956. The identity of the child that has been slaughtered in this house is 8-year-old Raylan Catherine Nirvana. She was born on Monday, July 4th, 1994, and died on Wednesday, April 2nd, 2003. Her height was 55 inches tall, her total weight was 61.5 pounds, and the total weight of her Christmas butt meat, her rump roast, is roughly 1.75 pounds. The total caloric amount in which is 3,936 calories. It served a total of roughly 18 people, 2 servings per person, roughly 9 people on average, roughly 6 people without sides, and roughly 12 people with sides. And finally, on the Christmas of 2003, her butt meat was defrosted, seasoned, cooked, dished out, served, and finally consumed as their family's Christmas roast after slaughtering her for not believing in Christmas. Well, that's gonna do it for Season 4, Case 21 of The Roast Game Theory. Stay tuned for 4 more cases, and then the finale will arrive. See you then. It began with Season 1, then the series revived itself with Season 2, then it continued with Season 3. Now with less than 5 cases to go, we are in the home stretch of the entire series. 5 more cases until the Roast Game Theory 2-part finale spectacular. After each case has been fully expanded upon, I will then collect the data and make statistics. These statistics will corroborate the child's racial, religious, and family background, the percentage of the suspects separated by gender, race, and religion. For example, what do you think is the percentage of the children that were slaughtered for not believing in Christmas are black, white, were raised by a single mother, a single father, or a complete family? At that point, your guess is as good as mine. Nobody knows. Stick around and you'll find out. The Roast Game Theory 2-part finale spectacular, coming September 3rd and 5th, 2021. Brace yourselves. May God have mercy on your soul. May Santa consume himself with the blood of 1,000 children he consumed before. And most importantly, stay tuned. Stay very, very tuned. Hello, everybody. It is I, Detective Brian Mullins the Fox, and welcome to Season 4, Case 22 of The Roast Game Theory. The house that I'm about to look at and investigate is 727 South Jones Street in Petersburg, Virginia. This home has 3 bedrooms, 2 bathrooms, 1,232 square feet of space, and was built in 1967. The identity of this child is 2-year-old Ian Edison Santiago. He was born on Friday, August 8th, 1997, and died on Saturday, February 26th, 2000. His height is 37 inches tall, his total weight is 30.2 pounds, and the weight of his Christmas butt meat is roughly a pound. The total caloric amount in which is 1,933 calories. It served a total of roughly 9 people, 2 servings per person, roughly 4.4 people on average, roughly 3 people without sides, and roughly 6 people with sides. And finally, on the Christmas of 2000, his butt meat was defrosted, seasoned, cooked, and consumed by his family as their Christmas roast after slaughtering him for not believing in Christmas. Well, that is gonna do it for Season 4, Case 22 of The Roast Game Theory. By the way, I got a very special announcement. This is the 100th child so far in the series that I have discovered and investigated the death of. I am Detective Brian Mullins the Fox, signing out. See you then. It began with Season 1, then the series revived itself with Season 2, then it continued with Season 3. Now with less than 5 cases to go, we are in the home stretch of the entire series. 5 more cases until the Roast Game Theory 2-part finale spectacular. After each case has been fully expanded upon, I will then collect the data and make statistics. These statistics will corroborate the child's racial, religious, and family background. The percentage of the suspects separated by gender, race, and religion. For example, what do you think is the percentage of the children that were slaughtered for not believing in Christmas are black, white, were raised by a single mother, a single father, or a complete family? At that point, your guess is as good as mine. Nobody knows. Stick around and you'll find out. The Roast Game Theory 2-part finale spectacular, coming September 3rd and 5th, 2021. Brace yourselves. May God have mercy on your soul. May Santa consume himself with the blood of 1,000 children he consumed before. And most importantly, stay tuned. Stay very, very tuned. Hello everyone, it is I, Detective Brian Mullins the Fox, and welcome to Season 4, Case 23 of The Roast Game Theory. The house that I'm about to look into is 124 Powell Street in Spencer, West Virginia. This home has 3 bedrooms, 2 bathrooms, 1,053 square feet of space, and was built in 1966. The identity of this child is 12-year-old Valentina Rhiannon Stephanie. She was born on Wednesday, October 28th, 1992, and died on Monday, December 6th, 2004. Her height was 59 inches tall. Her total weight is 91.5 pounds, and the weight of her Christmas butt meat is roughly 3 pounds, the total caloric amount in which is 5,856 calories. It served a total of roughly 18 people, 2 per person. Same on average, 4.4 people without sides and 8.8 with sides. And finally, on the Christmas of 2004, it happened. Her butt meat was defrosted, seasoned, cooked, prepared, dished out, and served, then consumed as her family's Christmas roast after slaughtering her for not believing in Christmas. Well, that'll do it for Season 4, Case 23 of The Roast Game Theory. We have only 2 more cases to go until the finale takes place. I am Detective Brian Mullins the Fox, signing out. See you then. It began with Season 1, then the series revived itself with Season 2, then it continued with Season 3. Now with less than 5 cases to go, we are in the home stretch of the entire series. 5 more cases until the Roast Game Theory 2-part finale spectacular. After each case has been fully expanded upon, I will then collect the data and make statistics. These statistics will corroborate the child's racial, religious, and family background. The percentage of the suspects separated by gender, race, and religion. For example, what do you think is the percentage of the children that were slaughtered for not believing in Christmas are black, white, were raised by a single mother, a single father, or a complete family? At that point, your guess is as good as mine. Nobody knows. Stick around and you'll find out. The Roast Game Theory 2-part finale spectacular, coming September 3rd and 5th, 2021. Brace yourselves. May God have mercy on your soul. May Santa consume himself with the blood of 1,000 children he consumed before. And most importantly, stay tuned. Stay very, very tuned. Hello everybody, it is I, Detective Brian Mullins the Fox, and welcome to the next to last case of the entire series, Season 4, Case 24. The house that I'm about to look into is 5856 Forson Drive in Cincinnati, Ohio. This home has 3 bedrooms, 2 bathrooms, 1860 square feet of space, and was built in 1962. The identity of this child is 4-year-old Elton Lorenzo Collins. He was born on Wednesday, September 11th, 1996, and died on Monday, January 22nd, 2001. His height was 42.3 inches. His total weight was 38 pounds, the weight of his Christmas butt meat is roughly 1 pound. The total caloric amount in which is 2,432 calories. It served a total of 11 people, 2 servings per person, 5.5 on average, roughly 4 without sides, and 7 with sides. And finally, on the Christmas of 2001, it happened. His butt meat was defrosted, seasoned, cooked, prepared, dished out, and consumed by his family as their Christmas roast after slaughtering him for not believing in Christmas. How shocking. I am Detective Brian Mullins the Fox, and I'm proud to announce that this series, and this season as well, is nearly over. I'm signing out, by the way. See you then. It began with Season 1, then the series revived itself with Season 2, then it continued with Season 3. Now with less than 5 cases to go, we are in the home stretch of the entire series. 5 more cases until the Roast Game Theory 2-part finale spectacular. After each case has been fully expanded upon, I will then collect the data and make statistics. These statistics will corroborate the child's racial, religious, and family background, the percentage of the suspects separated by gender, race, and religion. For example, what do you think is the percentage of the children that were slaughtered for not believing in Christmas are black, white, were raised by a single mother, a single father, or a complete family? At that point, your guess is as good as mine. Nobody knows. Stick around and you'll find out. The Roast Game Theory 2-part finale spectacular, coming September 3rd and 5th, 2021. Brace yourselves. May God have mercy on your soul. May Santa consume himself with the blood of 1,000 children he consumed before. And most importantly, stay tuned. Stay very, very tuned.
Thank you.
Hello everybody, it is I, Detective Brian Mullins the Fox, and welcome to Season 4, Case 25, the very last case of not just the fourth season, but the entire series as well. The house that I'm about to investigate is 102 Arbor Lane in Lumberton, North Carolina. This house has 3 bedrooms, 2 bathrooms, 1,512 square feet of space, and was built in 1970. The identity of this child is 5-year-old Vincent Floyd Corbin. He was born on Friday, December 1st, 1995, and died on Saturday, November 3rd, 2001. His height was roughly 43 inches tall. His total weight was roughly 40 and a half pounds. The weight of his Christmas butt meat is roughly 1.2 pounds. The total caloric amount in which is 2,592 calories. It served a total of roughly 12 people, 2 servings per person, roughly 6 people on average, roughly 4 people without sides, and roughly 8 people with sides. And finally, on the Christmas of 2001, it finally happened. His butt meat was defrosted, seasoned, cooked, dished out, prepared, and consumed by his family as their Christmas roast after slaughtering him for not believing in Christmas. Well, that'll do it for the very last case of the roast game theory. Stay tuned for the 2-part finale spectacular to come. See you then. Now, you've just witnessed 4 entire seasons, over 3 years, 100 cases, and over 100 slaughterhouses investigated. After all the opening, closing logos, parody logos, teaser promos, and seasonal vibes, nothing will be sweeter than this. Now, Brian Mullins the Fox proudly presents a collection of statistics and factors to put the pieces to the puzzle back together. The Roast Game Theory's 2-part finale spectacular. The Roast Game Theory's 2-part finale spectacular. All that you ever wanted in a series, and so much more. Only from Brian Mullins the Fox. Hello everybody, I am Detective Brian Mullins the Fox. Welcome to the be all end all to prove the roast game phenomenon once and for all. here was how this is all gonna go down. First, we'll go through all the 100 cases, find the suspect's name by either the first letter or a few unique letters in their first name. If I found any criminal records, I will name the families at the time of each slaughter, like this, the surnames. Then I will go to each individual court, public, or criminal record website and look for the exact case. Whether or not if I find it, or if there is no criminal record at all, it depends. So my confidence was at best 95%. To confirm this theory, either the parent or family member will get a criminal record that's impossible to expunge, or let off the hook scot-free due to lack of evidence. That's literally all I have to do. I did enough research in the past 2 years or so to rule out turkey, ham, roast beef, and chicken as the centerpiece of Christmas dinner from 1998 to 2016. There is a stark difference between Thanksgiving and Christmas, statistically, and I've done a video before delving into that subject. Thanksgiving, on one hand, has self-contradictory statistics, but the choice of meat has been well documented since Thanksgiving was declared a holiday in the United States on November 26, 1863. Turkey and ham. But Christmas, on the other hand, has contradictory consumption statistics, one article after another. The main choice of meat wasn't clearly determined or documented, and was not ham or turkey at all. In fact, tons and tons of that meat was thrown out and has caused a global pork shortage. Christmas is sus as hell, I swear to God. From waste statistics to contradictory consumption statistics, then to how the calories don't add up for the other choices of meat other than children, and so forth. During the production of season 4 of The Roast Game Theory, even though it happened, I couldn't find any criminal record. So that proves my theory. I promised to find criminal records to the contrary of every single case in this series. And to no one's surprise, I didn't find any relating to any other horrific crime. Even if I were to find one other than the murders that are committed in each case, it wouldn't guarantee 100% accuracy to me. I couldn't find the names of those who did it, so I will assume which family member did it by labeling them only mothers and fathers, not any other family members, in spite of them actually being the leading family members. But here is how I will find out who did it, though, and find the trend to definitively prove this theory and the phenomenon itself. Here are the 7 steps to definitively prove this theory. Step 1. Reanalyze the stains. Re-verify if it's blood. Step 2. Use the death toll to create a stark contrast with statistics and pie graphs. Step 3. Find who actually did it by math. Like, find the relationship of the potential suspect, not their actual names. Step 4. Link it to them. Add context. Find the family that's complicit in these actions. Step 5. Re-verify the evidence. Double check if it's not attached to any other crime, like I've done before. Step 6. Find the trend. And finally, step 7. Collect the data. Now let's illustrate the child casualty demographics. How many of these 103 children are male? The answer is 71. How many of these 103 children are female? The answer is 32. How many of them are white? 66. How many of them are African American? The answer is 30. How many of them are Latino American? 6. And finally, how many of them are Asian American? The answer is 1. Now let's actually take the roast game total death toll into consideration, starting with race slash ethnicity, with whites taking the biggest margin and chunk of the pie chart with 64.1% of the total death toll, or 11,898,581. The second biggest chunk of the pie chart, and what comes in second place, are African Americans, with 5,384,813, or 29% of the total death toll. Next are the Latino Americans, with only 185,683 children, or 1% of the death toll. Other races like non-Hispanics, non-whites, non-blacks, Italian-Americans, Native Americans, yada yada yada, with 1,099,245 children, or 5.9%, with Asian Americans taking last place for the amount of deaths in the total death toll. And I did add the death toll of Asian American children as part of other races. Even with that, it's much smaller than any other race combined in this death toll. That includes interracial families, a mix of white, a mix of black, a mix of Hispanic, and a mix of Asian, yada yada yada. Now let's move on to gender, with males taking the biggest chunk of the pie chart with 68.9% of the death toll, or 12,793,573 boys, and the females with the minority of 5,774,748 girls. Now let's head on into family structure. Out of all the 103 children I have discovered to be slaughtered, their butt meats cut off, defrosted, seasoned, cooked, then eaten as their Christmas roast after slaughtering him or her for not believing in Christmas, 41 of the 103 children, which is 39.8% of which, were killed by a single mother. That's roughly 1 in 3 children. Roughly 1 in 11, or 9 children in the bunch, or 8.7%, were killed by a single father. 27.2%, which is roughly 1 in 4, or 28 in the bunch, were killed by a married mother. And finally, 25% of children, which is about 1 in 4 children, or 25 from the bunch, were killed by a married father. In the total death toll, the amount of children that were killed by single mothers in total is 7,390,192. The death toll of children that were killed by single fathers is 1,615,444. The death toll of the children that were killed by married mothers is 5,050,584 children. And finally, the total death toll of children that were killed by married fathers is 4,512,102 children. None were killed by any other family members, even though mothers and fathers, regardless if they're single or not, are counted as leading family members. In part 2, I will demonstrate a code system to determine which child was killed by which family member. Single mother, single father, married mother, or married father. A for single mother, B for single father, C for married mother, and D for married father. And finally, let's go to the final factor before we conclude the first out of two parts of this finale. Spectacular. Number 4, religion. Generally speaking, the vast majority of families in which these children were consumed were Christian. Other religions are a minority. To conclude this very long first part, I just want to recap what we've learned in this episode of The Roast Game Theory. Not in chronological order. Number 1, the demographic that killed the most children for not believing in Christmas were white single mothers. 2, the demographic that killed the least children for not believing in Christmas were Asian single fathers. Number 3, the death toll adds up, still, but in a more detailed and statistical way. Number 4, visual evidence from every single case is confirmed to show / contain bloodstains, alongside with other bodily fluids in some. Number 5, the trend is there, the roast game is a fact. And finally, number 6, I am Detective Brian Mullins the Fox, signing out. See you all in part 2. And stay tuned for a post-series teaser promo for The Adventurous Mischiefs in a Post-Detective World. Bye now.
1. A. 2. B. 3. C. 4. A. 5. C. 6. D. 7. A. 8. D. 9. C. 10. A. 11. C. 12. D. 13. A. 14. B. 15. C. 16. A. 17. D. 18. C. 19. A. 20. C. 21. D. 22. A. 23. D. 24. C. 25. A. 26. B. 27. D. 28. A. 29. C. 30. D. 31. A. 32. D. 33. C. 34. A. 35. D. 36. C. 37. A. 38. B. 39. D. 40. A. 41. C. 42. D. 43. A. 44. C. 45. D. 46. A. 47. C. 48. D. 49. A. 50. B. 51. D. 52. A. 53. C. 54. D. 55. A. 56. D. 57. C. 58. A. 59. D. 60. C. 61. B. 62. A. 63. C. 64. A. 65. D. 66. C. 67. A. 68. D. 69. C. 70. A. 71. D. 72. B. 73. A. 74. C. 75. D. 76. A. 77. C. 78. D. 79. A. 80. C. 81. D. 82. A. 83. B. 84. C. 85. A. 86. D. 87. C. 88. A. 89. D. 90. C. 91. A. 92. C. 93. D. 94. A. 95. B. 96. C. 97. A. 98. D. 99. C. 100. A. 101. D. 102. C. 103.
Hello, everyone. It is I, Detective Brian Mullins the Fox, and this is my farewell message. It has been a wonderful 3 years of this entire series. 4 whole seasons, 100 cases, over 100 slaughterhouses investigated, and 103 children discovered to have been slaughtered for not believing in Christmas. And all I have to do now is hang in the towel, take off my detective coat, detective hat, and the sort of detective ego off. I'm retiring. Hopefully this series was just as helpful for you guys as it was for me. So long, farewell, goodbye the roast game theory, goodbye. Later on this year in 2021, the roast game, A Final Look, will look back into the series and analyze it in a nutshell. Stay tuned for a very special teaser promo for The Adventurous Mischiefs in a Post-Detective World. I am Detective Brian Mullins the Fox. Have a nice day. Coming this fall from Brian Mullins the Fox, it's The Adventurous Mischiefs in a Post-Detective World, a brand new vlog series after the fact that the roast game theory as a series is over. Stay tuned, my friends. You've waited 3 years all for this. Don't bet against yourselves, cause it's about to get interesting. Woo-hoo-hoo-hoo! The Adventurous Mischiefs in a Post-Detective World. Take off your hat, throw it like a frisbee across the street, jump in the groove, and hold on lock steady, because you can't let all this fun slip from out of your hands.
We'll be right back.
Hello everybody, I am Brian Mullins the Fox. This is the final roast game commentary segment of this final roast game video that I will make that is part of the same conversation. This is just in case if nothing else happens after the roast game of Final Look premieres. Here are three things that we'll know for sure beyond the shadow of a doubt. The roast game theory will be a confirmed theory regardless, not based on conspiracy, for no one is required to have planned any of these murders if they are spontaneous and in private, because the child was more likely left to decompose and rot within the privacy of their own home where no one's looking or hearing them scream as they bled to death from the back end. I would even have the brass balls to assume the opposite of conspiracy, since no parent or family member worth their salt or worth their heart would ever agree to do such a thing or plan it in the first place. There is no accurate way to count or take into account every murder, not just the murder of children, murder of men and women, that goes unreported, or at least not the 250,000 number that gets constantly cited when it comes to unreported murders. Number two, we'll get even better Christmas turkey and ham statistics in the future. So the roast game will no longer be a problem of the present, but a thing of the past. I've made a rant video about this, in which I will play a clip of for shits and goddamn giggles. Because why not? It's hard to believe how swift people were to go right back to turkey and ham again in 2017, 18, 19, and 2020. It blows my mind, baffles me numb, and dumbfounds me stupid that they would be so deliberate and meticulous with their actions. I can't believe how quick they were to switch back, since it seems almost effortless to do so at this point. Millions of both Americans and Canadians throw every single shank and whole piece of ham and turkey away. They see commercials on the TV for such products and wonder why there's a global pork shortage. You wonder why the history of Christmas dinner is now more checkered than the checkered flag itself. More bad times than good, ever. It really disappoints the hell out of me that anyone with a straight face would possibly tell me that they would never do such a thing, when the complacency is always made apparent. I can never trust a single person at that point to take care of their own children. It really just seems that children don't even matter anymore. Why would you have kids to raise, educate, and send them off into the world around them as adults, if the only option, since you as an American and even Canadian, during the roughly 19-year period of the roast game era, is to just downright slaughter them, cut out their back ends, then leave them all alone to bleed, die, decompose, and merely fester and rot as a stain of the existence that would have stood between tradition and humanity. A reminder of what potential was in this child's life. Humanity is meaningless at this point. The smell of death in this situation is nostalgic as fuck and gives me weird and creepy vibes all the fuck over. Like, Jesus fucking Christ. Like, holy shit. Imagine this. Put this into your thicker, hollow fucking skulls for a moment. They've been eating their own children as their Christmas roast for 18 Christmases, or roughly 19 years. During that period, Americans came back to eating ham or turkey as the hallmark of Christmas dinner again after 20 years. 20 fucking years, ladies and gentlemen. 20 fucking years. Two whole decades since they last held true to their traditions. That is quite shocking. An entire generation of young Americans and Canadians wasted within the complacency and the downright fortitude to not break down and cry. Let all of that sink in as you cope with your life never being enough for the next generation and wonder to yourself, even if I survived, was it still fucking worth it? What would it take for you to demonstrate to Generation Alpha that their generation is nowhere near in harm's way? There's a fucking pandemic that's about to fucking destroy their lives. It's impacting children. There are Karens out there nosy beyond belief. and schools would still likely be either closed or they will have to learn online. And even when the schools are open, their hours are stifled and cut short. I literally get chills down my spine, my legs, and even down to my ass as I worked so hard to put all of this into perspective within almost 3.5 years, if not 4, by the time the Roast Game of Final Look premieres in December this year. And at this point, I have nothing else to say. I am almost out of breath because I became so passionate. Passionate that my generation has failed me, and the other generation or two failed it before. Number 3. The discussion is over. The roast game is a fact. Here is only one question that I have not quite answered yet or gotten to the bottom of just yet. Are families legally required to report these dead children death certificate-wise after slaughtering them for their butt meat for not believing in Christmas? To put it bluntly, no, they are not required to publish, let alone require one at all. Just because they legally need to do so regarding other causes of death or even not having to do with the death of a child at all, does not mean that they will be arrested or sent to jail or prison for refusing to do so. Death certificates are only required if and when it comes to child support, when it comes to the death of a parent or sole custody owner, a mother or father. It basically means that if you get a death certificate for an individual, not a child obviously, you can do these things as cited here. According to an article written by a contributing writer for Cake Blogs, Sam Tetrault, Bachelor of Arts in English. A death note is a way to announce that someone died. These are factual accounts with fewer details about the deceased. They typically only include vital information such as the date of death and information about the funeral. However, unlike obituaries, there is sometimes a legal need to publish them. Are there legal requirements for death notices? If assets need to be distributed to beneficiaries or heirs, the estate executor or local government might publish the death notice publicly. If the heirs are unknown, this is a way for them to learn the death and claim the assets that belong to them. Another reason the estate planning attorney or probate court might publish a death notice as a notice to creditors if the deceased person left debt. The published death notice allows creditors to file a claim against the estate. If a death notice is necessary for creditor or beneficiary purposes, pay attention to the following. Timing. Many states require the death notice to be soon after the death. It also might run several times over a period of time to ensure it's seen by the general public. Location. Additionally, state laws often require the death notice to be in the person's county of residence. Some states will even publish it on the radio, TV, or another type of broadcast. When in doubt, consult with your local probate court or an estate attorney. They'll have the best information for your specific situation. Who publishes a death notice? Unlike an obituary, the death notice is not only published by the family, it can be published by a local probate court, estate attorney, estate executor, or family member. Anyone who has reason to believe there needs to be an official statement of the deceased person's death has the option to publish a death notice. Other requirements to be aware of. Though there is no legal requirement to publish an obituary or death certificate, let alone order or require one, except in the case of unknown beneficiaries or creditors, there are still legal requirements and etiquette to be aware of. Familiarize yourself with these other requirements below so you know what to expect. What documents are legally required? The document you legally need when a loved one dies is a death certificate. Whenever a person dies, this death is registered with the local or state vital records office. This happens within days of the death. Where do you get a death certificate? If your loved one passes away in a hospital or long-term care facility, they will prepare this for you. Otherwise, the death report is typically filed through the funeral home or cremation organization. To do this, you'll need to provide information about the deceased, like their full name, birth date and place, family information, and cause of death. The death certificate is necessary for a number of important legal and financial steps: accessing pension benefits, claiming life insurance, settling the estate, getting married in the case of a widow remarrying, local public health data. To learn how to get a death certificate for your loved one is through your local or state vital records office. You'll receive a copy of the certificate within a few weeks of the death, which you'll be able to use for any financial or legal needs after the death, and only those. What needs to be published? The family does not need to publish anything, assuming there are no unknown beneficiaries or creditors. Aside from the death certificate, there are no legal documents required when someone dies. However, it's common etiquette to publish either a death notice, obituary, or both when a loved one dies. Hey everyone, this is going to be a rant of many passions. A rant of many angles and new layers. First, before I start this rant video, I would like to thank you all for getting my channel up to over 10,000 subscribers. It's been a long and arduous journey that I will continue to go on. Thank you for all of your support. I will continue to make awesome and intriguing content that triggers the curiosity in all of us, because I am a Sigma male. Last thing before I begin the rant, I just want to note that to this day, 4 years ago, the first roast game debate began. This debate basically boils down to me introducing an interesting hypothetical that led me to dive deeper into the more philosophical issue. The opponent of this debate basically just said, "I don't know what the fuck this is supposed to be or mean, so I'm not going to understand it." Then it ended in me winning by 7 points due to the opponent's concession. Then the second debate came in November of 2017, and that was the best and only debate that actually got to the facts and argumentations of each side. The basic question was, should Christmas end? So I was the pro and my opponent was the con. After a long and arduous debate, I won by 5 points. The voter of said debate said that he voted con even though he didn't. The roast game debate shitstorm saga was one of the longest dramas I went through. It spanned from since after the first debate all the way up to February 21st or 22nd of 2018. A few days later, I started this channel called Brian Mullins the Fox on the 27th of February 2018. Another example of an ongoing drama ensued, and it got me to be much more self-aware of people that take advantage of you for personal and political gain. For fuck's sake, I used to identify myself as a centrist social libertarian, and I used to watch content from Shane Killian, Esoteric Entity, Filthy Heretic, and others. But then my views began to change. I am now a centrist social deadtarian. It led me to burn more bridges, then I learned a lot more out of the general debate portion of the discussion. The roast game of Final Look will delve into basically everything in December, from the 15th all the way up to Christmas Day, just before the Mistress Elaminello story. But you might ask, well, gee fucking whiz, what should I do in the meantime until then? Come with me and celebrate the 4-year-long discussion and attend its funeral today. Not only that the topic is dead, but the discussion is dead as well. It's over, plain and simple. I don't want to forget it and just carry on. As long as it's dead, keep all this shit in memory and even history. One day, this dead topic will get the spotlight again, but only for a little while. And maybe it won't be the main topic at all, it'll be just the case. And each case at that will be the main topic. And beyond the shadow of a doubt, I know I won't ever get respect from those I've already burned bridges with. So be it, I don't give a fuck. That's their problem, not mine. I've made multiple videos talking about what the hell just happened with me. In a video called How to Not Be Wrong About Drama / False Accusations, which I released on February 19th of this year. And throughout the many old drama videos of 1 to 2, if not 3 years ago. All of them. Individual. So the drama is not important. And by the way, in part 1 of the roast game of Final Look, I said I was gonna get to the drama in part 10, but I didn't have to. I've gotten to some, if not most of it, in part 9, and some chunks of it left in part 10. So before I end this video, let's say the final parting words to this topic here on out. The roast game is a fact. The calories add up. Keep all of this in memory, not just in America, but in Canada as well. Over 100 million children die due to all of this. In fact, I'll give you the specific tally. 104,632,147. Thank you all for standing by. I am Brian Mullins the Fox, signing out. Have a good night, everybody. I have ranted about the drama on and off, but for obvious reasons, I won't mention any of them, because to me, the dust has already settled. None of the other people that I had beef with back in 2019 has anything else to say about me or anything like that. We're not really having any problems at the moment, none whatsoever. I'm not going to look back at any of them, because it is so tiring to do ever so constantly. I am just tired of doing all of this. I really am. So let's finish this series off accordingly, shall we? What I will rant about is all the effort, the research, the time it took me to make all of these videos, the time it took me to fully cope and recover from all these 5 dramas. Spanning over 2 years, from October of 2017 all the way up to 2019. All of it, this entire time, was totally worth it. The local news media may or may not resurface some, if not all, these cases in the long run with these stories. The police arrest and lock up the parent who engaged in the murder and desecration of the corpse of each and every single child I've discovered. Hell, even if major food companies, mainstream media outlets, and everyone else admits to every single fucking thing that we have learned over the span of 4 years, I wouldn't be surprised that they did, even a little bit. It wouldn't really faze me all that much. Maybe one night or day, I could have myself a good cry here or there, cope with the realization of the fact, and keep moving on with my life. Honestly, this rant won't be too long. I won't go off on any of the people who betted against me or call me a quote-unquote conspiracy theorist, because quite frankly, they don't deserve any more attention. They have nothing of value to say, and they will waste your time when need to do so. They will run dirty ops against you in their toxic Discord servers. They will make fun of the fact that you exist. They will give you no platform or time to speak up to defend yourself or recuse yourself, even if you were to be stupid enough to fall for their come talk to me on Discord bait. They will make a live stream gathering up evidence of what you did and then talk shit about you, even if it's such a petty topic. To be fair, even after this series is over, I wouldn't even get the chance to catch a break from all of this shit resurfacing in real life. I would constantly get bombarded with these cases yet again. That's not my fault. It would only be the timing and convenience. Anytime each case or whatever resurfaces, I will cover each in another video in the long and distant future. And after all of that, by the time the roast game debate from October 20th, 2017 turns 5 years old, which is half a fucking decade, it will still ring true. It will still have that bite. It'll still have that argumentative value. Even after all that, it'll still be worth it. Before I close out this entire series, I would love it if you guys share this entire series, hit the like button, subscribe, and click the notification bell to see any more content on my channel. Not just this type of content anymore, but any other type of content. I am Brian Mullins the Fox, signing out. Have a very Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. And by the time this premieres, I will also say goodbye to 2021. Goodbye to you all.